light, spiritual life, stuff like that. But I'm not planning to talk about personal change, which is very much within your own control, usually, often a necessary part of working for change, but it's not what I'm planning to talk about. Nor am I planning to talk about living with the changes you can't avoid. We all know about those just at the moment, but that's going to feature a bit. And I don't think I've ever really been in a position where I've got the authority, had the authority to require change, to say, make it so. Although there may have been times in the past when I thought I had that authority, but didn't really. But there are many situations where change seems to be needed and opportunities need to be actively sought to move the change forward and to understand your part in it. And that need for change won't occur at the same time and in the same way to everyone affected by the change. You might not see clearly what your part in the change can be. So what working for change means to me is that it's that tense and messy state where things aren't clear, where people don't always see things in the same way you do, where the urgency that you feel for change has to be tempered by the patience of bringing people with you, or even, God forbid, your necessary change of direction of approach because you were mistaken in some way. So I wanted to illustrate that sort of tension in terms of two things, which in my life, I'm in that state where I believe I'm working for change, but it's not really easy to see where it's going to go. The first one's to do with sustainability and climate change, and I think most Quakers will recognise this. And it's very clear that, certainly in Bristol, we can all agree on minutes of commitment, but it's incredibly hard to work together at the same pace towards the right kind of change without some degree of hypocrisy somewhere in the system. And my personal challenge here is maintaining the sense of urgency and passion that has led to significant changes in my own personal behaviour, however belatedly, very late to this game compared to some people on this screen. But I have made some very significant changes to my life, and they've been driven by a sense of urgency and passion. But at the same time, I'm having to be tolerant of those who haven't found a way to make changes themselves, or indeed actively resist the need for change at all. And in working with other organisations dealing with this, it's a massive tension. I've been doing quite a bit of work with Zero West, where it's really hard for some people to live with that tension of wanting big, urgent change, but having to be so patient and realizing that it's not going to happen in the time frame they want it to. And it leads to a real personal conflict, which can come out in some sometimes unconstructive ways. Another area is homelessness. Steve mentioned that about me. So for many years, I've worked alongside homeless people in one way or another. Most of this has been with the Julian Trust Night Shelter, where I've been a long volunteer for about 15 years and a trustee for a lot of that as well. And the Julian Trust Night Shelter is not currently able to open at all because of COVID. But I've also had a broader interest as a volunteer and trustee with other organisations, also Bristol Homeless Forum, for which I've been producing a weekly news bulletin. That's what kept me busy. That's what I was busy this morning. I've sent it out today. In that role, I'm keeping the sector informed of the many changes and opportunities to collaborate between different organisations. So the perspective I've got on the wider scene of homelessness has been quite hard to share with other Julian trustees and volunteers. Most of them are just focused on getting back to what they're used to as soon as it's safe to do so. I mean, the Julian Trust has been operating for 36 years, doing pretty much the same thing. It's fairly set in its ways, and what it's done in the past has been exactly what was needed, even though insufficient. But COVID has created a situation where rough sleepers have been helped off the streets in far greater numbers than ever before. I mean, this morning on this morning's Homeless Forum newsletter, I was able to say that last night's rough sleeper count was 21 people. This time last year, it was 95. And that was with a lot of hostels open, hostels and shelters open. So that something has changed for the better as a result of COVID in relation to rough sleepers. At the beginning of the COVID response, you've probably all heard of everyone in, the initial government response to get everyone off the streets. But even during the latest severe weather for a fortnight from New Year's Eve to 25 to from, you know, about a fortnight from New Year's Eve onwards, because of the severe cold weather, they made extra efforts to get people off the streets. And each night during that severe weather period, they had between 25 and 35 people accommodated on a temporary basis. But that's not the same 25, 35 people. During that 10 to 14 days, it actually translated to 85 people moved into longer-term accommodation. You know, that's significant. And at the end of the period, only 11 of those who were in on the day that that severe weather period closed, only 11 of those hadn't been found longer-term accommodation at that point. Many of the 11 since have. So it just shows that we don't need to do things the way that they've been done for those 20, 35 years before. This year has shown that things can be done in a different way. So what's been happening challenges the contribution of the approach that the country and the Julian Trust had before, where people were put into dormitory-style night shelters in significant numbers just to get them off the street. So I see this as an opportunity to change our approach to rough sleeping and homelessness by just not accepting that there should be a need for dormitory-style emergency night shelters again. But it's very hard to present that to an organisation that's done much the same thing for 35 years without it being received as a criticism of what they know how to do. So those two examples are my attempt to illustrate what I think is a feature of working for change, that it's, as I said, a tense and messy state where things aren't clear, where people don't always see things in the same way that you do, where the urgency you feel for change has to be tempered by the patience of bringing people with you, or your necessary change of direction or approach because you were mistaken in some way. As a final point, which isn't in the script that Heather saw, which I've deviated from a tiny bit, last night Heather and I saw a film which I think also illustrates this. It wasn't the purpose of the film, but I recommend it. It's called One Night in Miami. It's a fictional account based on true events of the night that Cassius Clay beat Sonny Liston and became world champion, and then announced in the morning that he was not to be known as Cassius Clay anymore because he'd converted to Islam. And this is a night where Muhammad Ali, as he became, and Malcolm X and Sam Cooke, the singer, and James Brown, the sportsman, were spent the night, instead of having a party at celebrating the Cassius Clay's victory, had a night of really tough conversation about the change that they were all involved in, that they were approaching in different ways with different senses of urgency, significant differences of opinion about how to do it. And that, to me, represents the tension that working for change is about. It's difficult, and the alternative is to not try. So if you're going to work for change, it's probably not going to be easy. That's it from me. I've left my little script with a "what does it mean for you?" Thank you, friends.
Stephen, you're muted. I think we need to unmute if we want to speak. And Stephen, I can't unmute him. I don't know if you all can hear me.
We can hear you, Patsy, but not Stephen.
Okay. Right, okay. I think Stephen has the means to mute and unmute everybody.
I'm coming back. Sorry.
Ah, there he is.
I lost my screen. Phew, now, some chairman or womanship is required here, because there's a lot of us. And Richard's introduced us to a very broad topic, really. We all believe in change, but it's difficult to know how to do it. I'm going to start, actually, by saying, with regard to homelessness, when I was involved with homelessness, we were handing out sandwiches and soup. We called it the soup run. And the different churches in Westminster took turns. And we, the Quakers, thought we did it better than others because we actually took our time, chatted to the people and found out if they needed sleeping bags and things. Whereas some of the other charities would just rush out, dish out the sandwiches and rush off again. So we sort of made some sort of personal contact. People criticized us, especially the government, because they said we were just encouraging people to stay homeless. So other Quakers were working on rent deposit schemes, helping people get into rented accommodation by finding the funds to pay their deposit. And other people were converting houses, and other people were politically campaigning for housing. And so people worked at all different levels. I think that's good, but it's not good if they start actually competing with each other or doing each other down and saying you're making a big mistake. So that's my reaction to what Richard has said. And now hope everybody else is going to contribute. If you want to speak, to save us all speaking at once, put your hand up like that, and I will, if as long as I remain chairing, I shall call you in. And Patsy, I don't know if you were demonstrating how to hold your hand up or saying I want to speak, so go ahead.
I wanted to speak because I'm somebody who has been homeless, and by homeless I mean having my belongings in two carrier bags. And I would like to say how much difference it made to me when, rather than, so to speak, being handed sandwiches, I was actually invited into someone's home to stay, as I was. I was just welcomed by people who didn't know me well at all, didn't know if I had a criminal record or something like that. They didn't know me except by talking to me and effectively giving me a sandwich. And it was a total turning point in my life because I had a room, and I had a safe space, and I had people to talk to. And I feel very strongly that having that space to yourself, no matter how small, as opposed to being, for example, in a dormitory, I would wholeheartedly support the importance of that. There's something about being able to close the door and yet at the same time knowing there are people on the other side of it that you can talk to. So that's my penny worth anyway.
Who else wants to speak? Ray.
Jenny.
I once came across rather a remarkable thing where I was reading about a person who was a big campaigner for international homeless, international change. But then it was found out that when the homeless hostel was planned for their street, they produced a very large campaign against it.
NIMBY.
It is something, you know, change is us. Change must mean that we, if need to be, we have to change ourselves as well.
Yeah. Jenny.
Right.
Jenny.
Well, I've been effectively homeless. I know what it's like. I had 17 places to live in 13 years, one of which was an army hut and hostels, hotels, sometimes with babies and children. A very disruptive life until I came to Bristol in 1972. And I said, I'm going out of this one in a little box. I am not being evicted or thrown out in any way. So, but I worked for shelter from 1982 for 15 years. I saw what homeless did to people. I saw how it could wreck lives. I saw how it could lead people to committing crimes just to survive. And I think we should be very careful about judgment. Richard, I go back to the time when Meg Grimes used to and be one of the main people in your organisation.
Jenny, can I interrupt you a sec? Some people are having a problem hearing you. Can you get a little bit closer to your device, please?
Well, the keyboard's got it. Anyway, Richard, I go back to Meg Grimes, which you knew. And I knew, and she was a lovely woman. And she would sometimes, when I was going out on site, give me food so I could take socks to people that hadn't got socks and have frostbite on their feet and were living rough. And I don't think people realise also, at one time we were running during the Christmas period, a night shelter in one of the church halls. And the one thing I remember about it was the moaning and the groans as people have bad dreams. They can't sleep properly when you're homeless. You often don't have a night's sleep. And sleep is what helps make you better and well. So I've seen homeless. I think what's being done at the moment is good, Richard. It's a step forward. My daughter works in housing and she says that they've been allocating more properties to homeless people than ever before. But what we need is the backup. I mean, sure, they get furniture, clothing, so people treat them with more respect and don't see where they might have come from. And to help them on the first road for a more organised life, that they don't slide backwards. So, Richard, I'm delighted to hear what's happening, but I think there's more work, and the change must be that you don't just put them into a home. You go and try and help with them with the first steps of what we think is a normal life, but accept that sometimes that may not be a normal life for them.
Can I come back on the homelessness stuff, because this is where this bit of conversation's going, and just add to that a bit. So this time last year, we had round about 100 people in shelters, in night shelters, where they were taken in overnight and then put out in the morning. There was some opportunity to engage with them and help them move on, and that was done to a degree, but very little. This year, as I say, we got 21 people on the streets. All those 21 are people known to the services who are refusing to come in and accept offers at the moment. And that's fine. That's the state some people are at, but they're not being ignored. They're known, they're being understood, they're constantly being made offers. The other people are in 24-hour accommodation. So they're in a room they can be in for the day. Now, there is a massive lack of community. There's the potential for loneliness and isolation. And so there is support needed of a different sort. But the worry of finding somewhere to sleep for the night is gone. The worry of having to trek the streets during the day has gone. So it's so much easier for them to accept and for services to be offered, whatever support that is. The mental health support is there, the drugs and alcohol use support is there. But there is still an urge for them, you know, that they lack what all of us are lacking at the moment is a proper sort of community sense, somewhere to go. They can speak to people in groups. But we're all kind of sharing that a bit at the minute, but it's being thought about. But the main thing is, when Meg started out the Julian Trust in the 80s, that there was nothing else for people on the streets. That there was nothing else there. And it's a good thing to provide. And there's been some people, you know, whose lives have effectively been saved by just that small kindness. But we can do better. I was at a conference on Tuesday, an online conference, where people were talking, and I put one of the quotes in today's Homeless Forum newsletter from someone, a participant. Nottingham experience with hotels during the everyone in thing is that the better the accommodation provided, the better the outcome. Connection with services and move on is much better when people are treated with dignity. And so we've shown that we can, because of the crisis that's on us, start to treat people with more dignity. The Church Winter Night Shelter project this year, and you know, one of my hats is Trustee of Housing Justice, who have been promoting Church Winter Night Shelters across the country over the last few years. It's been a great response, but they can't have a shelter in a church hall or it can't be done because of COVID. So they've hired a B&B. They've block booked a B&B from January to March. They haven't got many people in there. They can accommodate seven, but they're being accommodated in that B&B alongside paying customers. They're getting the same treatment. And they're getting a couple of volunteers going in every day to talk to them in a community space, socially distanced and everything else. But they're being treated like ordinary people, not put on a camp bed on the floor overnight and told to move on in the morning. And that in the first week, they'd already moved three people on. They've reconnected them with their homes and families, which is a magnificent improvement. So when you treat people with dignity and give them proper accommodation, not just warehouse them to get them off the streets. And the thing I think that in all this conversation about homelessness since COVID that really sort of shocked and moved me is when I heard about the situation in Canada, the Julian Trust has resisted. It's always had space to have more than the 18 beds we've had, but we haven't felt it was the right response. In Canada, they had in one town, and I forget which city it was Toronto or Ontario or Quebec, I don't know which one of the major cities, they had a night shelter that had 7,000 bed spaces. Now, if you get to a state where your society thinks that it's okay to put people up in you know, that many people in that kind of accommodation night after night, there is something drastically wrong. So clearly the answer is not that we may not need, but we need to look for change. We don't need to do things in the same way. And it's really very hard to get people to change their approach when they are desperate to get back to how things were. We've got a little bit of this within Quakers. I mean, we've got this meeting here. I don't think this kind of meeting would have happened very easily, certainly not with this particular group of people, if we didn't have Zoom, if we hadn't been forced into Zoom. And we've had a different experience of meetings for worship. which has had people coming to meetings for worship, contributing to business meetings who were unable to leave the house, not because of COVID, but because they find it difficult to get out of the house. Some people have been joining in with things because they've been enabled to do so where they haven't been before. Other people have been excluded for different reasons. So it's changed. But there are some who just want us to get back to meeting together, and we must be careful not to lose what we've gained here. We've got to capture the good bits and hang on to them, and accept some of this stuff that has been forced on us. But there's other stuff we can do out of it. But we will all feel differently about that, because we're all coping with this technology and environment in different ways. So we're going to have to be kind and patient with each other.
All right. Thank you. Another contribution? Hattie.
I'm relatively new to Quakers, and I'm really glad of the newsletter that Julia sends out. Oh, can you not hear me very right. well?
Well, only just. If you can get closer to your microphone, it would be nice.
The trouble is, I don't know if the microphone is this or this.
It's this, it's, the latter, the second
that one. That one.
Okay, thank you. I discovered it was this one day. Yeah, so I feel grateful for this meeting, actually, because I feel I've got to see you and know your names a bit better. However, I also feel it's a bit precarious because I don't know, for instance, how to pick up a phone to any of you or to email you, because perhaps just I've got a mental block about some kind of list of emails. I don't know. You know, for instance, I would like to talk to Richard about working as a volunteer, because I really mind about homelessness. Okay, I do refugees instead, I suppose. But yes, I do value this group, and I do value the way that Zoom has really changed how I've participated and interacted. But I feel my thread is Julia's weekly newsletter at the moment on the email.
Julia, not all of us know that newsletter. Andy, what meeting are you at?
Redland.
What?
Redland.
Oh, Redland, okay.
Yeah, but I go to early morning, and so I meet, you know, six or eight of us, and so you're all quite different to me. Yes, Helen.
Okay, thank you. Heather?
Yes, just to say the newsletter that you mentioned is, I'm not sure Julia thinks of it as a newsletter. It's okay. A list of notices. It's wrong a very word. Full list of notices and very, very useful. And it is a kind of, it is a newsletter in itself. But that's, I think, what Hattie is referring to. It goes to members of Redland, and it tells us what's going on. Yeah.
We've just acquired an excellent new transferred member who seems to be starting a newsletter at Central meeting, and we've been sadly missing it for a long time. Who else wants to say something? Don't brush your hair just when I ask that question. Is it Anne or is it Linda wanting to speak, or are you just sort of brushing your hair aside? No? Oh, anybody else then? David, don't forget to unmute yourself.
I done it. Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Richard. It's a lovely, lovely topic for discussion. I really appreciate it, and I'm really pleased to see it kick off with homelessness. I thought for a long time in Bristol, I've been, you know, wandering the streets and seeing more and more people on the streets, and thinking that the, you know, the biggest indicator of a shift in consciousness would be not seeing people sleeping rough, not because of hiding them, but because it was somehow sorted. And I thought it was just wonderful, really, at the start of COVID, when the government said, right, you know, get them off the streets, you know, by this weekend. And that was on a Thursday. You know, it's fantastic. And it wasn't all sorted quickly, but, you know, you're telling us about remarkable progress, and it's wonderful to hear. And I think we all want that in so many areas of society. And, you know, there are big conversations happening at the moment about building back better. And I don't know about anybody else. I was in hospital recently. I was actually in hospital at the time of the storming of the Capitol. And it seemed like a tipping point, that something turned around, that we, you know, realized just how far we had gone in the wrong direction. And it's, you know, it's wonderful to see a group coming into administration in the United States who are committed to big social change and to have reversed things very, very quickly. And I just hope that we start to see all that in our country. Just one point, you know, the ability to change sometimes depends on having a vision of what's possible. It also depends for a lot of people on actually tackling trauma, because people who are frozen in some way from past experience just find it difficult to change. The thought of change is scary. So there's part of tackling change is healing the big issues, and recognizing them. Of course, you know, Bristol sleepwalks its way around its past of, you know, slavery and piracy and warmongering, you know, armaments building and all of those things, which we kind of need to tackle. So I just wanted to say that, but to thank you for opening up this topic. It's beautiful.
Thank you. Graham.
Thank you to Richard for his talk and demonstration of brevity, which I shall try to emulate in future, but I'm interested in the 21 who choose to stay on the streets despite offers of
Graham. You also need Graham. You need to speak closer to your microphone. It's very faint.
I am moving closer to.
That's better. That's a bit better.
I'm interested in the 21 who choose to stay on the streets and decline offers to accept, obviously, much better accommodation. What reasons do they give? What condition are they in which forces them apparently to choose cold and discomfort rather than the security of a room?
I think I need to answer that directly, but David has indicated something. There is going to be a lot of trauma in people's past lives that led them to be on the streets in the first place. I don't know that it's 21 individuals, but I know that there are people who will know each of those individual circumstances, and they will be different. So I can only give a very general supposition. So for example, someone who's found that they just can't cope with being in a room on their own because it's too lonely for them, might be one reason. It might be that the step to accommodation and getting the help they want, they're just not ready for, because it means facing up to challenges of the past. They are possibly on Class A drugs or significant alcohol abusers, and they're doing that for a reason. They're doing that not because they just want to get high. They're doing it to hide past hurt. So coming off it is going to be very difficult for them, and they may have tried it before and failed. And if you try to come off if you've been living on the street and you know you can handle it, but you know that every time you try to come off the street and change your lifestyle, you're going to have to face those hurts again. You know, it's not just, oh, I've got a room, everything's sorted. It's, I've got a room, now I've got to speak to people, I've got to address my past, I've got to think of changing. It's difficult for people to do that, really, really hard. So they prefer to stay where they are because it's less, they're used to it, it's less challenging. The thing that has made it easier for some people to get off the streets during the Everyone In is because there was no one in the shops, because the high streets were empty, they couldn't get money from begging. They couldn't pay for their drugs. So they came in, they got substitute treatment, they got methadone scripts, they got helped off. That was the impetus they needed for some people, but not for all. Because for some, they'll still find a way to pay for the drugs they need to keep the pain. So, you know, that you can't make a generalization about this. I know I've just attempted to, but that doesn't mean that everyone that is out there for those reasons I've described. They're just the ones I'm familiar with from the collection of stories I've heard. But believe me, these reasons are all deeply personal. And it's because they're facing the need for personal change that they can't face at the moment. It's too difficult. And it may very well be because they've tried it in the past and it's been too painful.
Anne, don't forget to unmute yourself.
That begs a question. So when you see people sleeping up on the street, is it right to donate or give them money or not? I struggle with that one. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't.
This is the big question. This is a massive question. This is the same sort of question that Stephen was raising when he spoke about soup runs and giving things out. What should you do? In some ways, you are enabling them. But what about it? I think the best answer I can give to that is the one that I heard Will Self give when he was brought to a homeless awareness week event we arranged at the Watershed 2 or 3 years ago. He gave the answer that wasn't comfortable to many people in the room. He said, sure, give them money, but treat them honestly. So he described a situation that a guy that he saw begging, and he knew because he'd been there himself that this guy was going to spend the money on drugs. And so he said, you know, he said, look, I can give you some money, but you've got to be honest about what you're going to use it for. When the guy said, oh, I'll go buy some food, he said, no, you're not. You're not giving you that. What are you going to do with this tenner? He said, well, I'm going to get some drugs. Okay. So he gave him the money. But he kept then going back, speaking to this guy to talk about what was going on for him. So he didn't just give him the money and walk away, think job done. He said, no, I've built a relationship with this chap and I'm going to keep talking to him. And yes, as long as he's unable to change, I'll just be alongside him. And yes, he was enabling his drug taking. But because he engaged with him, because he had a conversation, eventually that conversation helped the guy get into treatment. So if you're going to do it, don't think that's the end of it. It's the start of something. It's the start of a relationship.
I just wanted to say I completely agree with you. The idea of people standing alongside you until you are able to make whatever change is required yourself is crucial. I think that man was doing a very intuitively excellent thing, and I'm sure it made a difference to the man's life. It's having someone that you can be honest with, even if you are continuing to use drugs or alcohol, whatever your support substance is. Very helpful indeed.
Can I say something? I haven't got much experience with working with homelessness. I've done a lot of care work. I travelled for many, many years to stay, you know, my mum's home looking after in the Northwest. So I've got experience with that, but I always try to say something to the homeless and give money. But once I gave somebody £5, I mean, I can't even really afford £10 because I'm unwaged. But his attitude was quite odd. he sort of discarded it. He just pushed it to one side and he started rolling his cigarette. And I didn't take it personally, but I thought, oh, he wants the £5 and he probably did spend it on drugs and things, but he wanted other things. You know, he wanted a home and comfort and friendship again or whatever. But I thought, well, did I do the wrong thing? I mean, I wasn't bothered about it, but I just felt as if I should give a bit more that day. But I don't think I'd do it again. I'd just give small amounts. But his attitude was quite, and he didn't want to engage in, he engaged a little bit in conversation, but I felt as if I'd embarrassed him somehow. So they do want, you know, and all the people who do look after them, I admire them. It's just something that I don't do. I've done a lot of care work. Yeah.
Thank you, Linda.
Thank you very much indeed for all you do in Bristol. It's very good. I've finished now.
Okay, thank you. Hattie?
Just to give an example, I was in Japan and I gave somebody some money who was in rags and walking around and he hit me.
Oh, dear. Look, we've only got half an hour left, and I just wanted to, well, I want to raise another topic. Richard said it's about change, and we've talked mostly about change in the area of homelessness, but as Quakers, we very much want massive change in the world, don't we? Change in all sorts of huge areas. And how do we help get that change? Now, one way that it seems to me Quakers love is individual example, very small groups working on little innovative projects and so on. So we send somebody out to Kosovo for a peace center or something. Hardly anybody actually hears about it except other Quakers. What's the big problem against change? Take this housing one. Why did suddenly the homeless people get swept off the streets and into hotels? It was because the government saw the priority was COVID. Normally their priority is reducing tax, keep the taxes down. It's not just meanness, it's not just selfishness, it's a philosophy that is a good thing to have self-reliance, to have some people very successful helping society, other people falling by the wayside because they didn't try hard enough or just tough luck. The poor are always with us. There's that is a powerful philosophy which dominates our society. There's the people who desperately want all these lovely things like nobody's homeless and everybody can get into hospital and so on, are people like us, but we're not effectual because we don't, well, we are effectual as we can be, but I will assert that the solution lies in the political arena rather than the personal example arena. Personal example, yes, but we've also got to change politics at a high level, which means international legislation against tax havens, for instance, which Cameron actually did do something about. And it means fairer taxes all through. And it means persuading people that tax is not a bad thing. So I don't know what I can say about that, but that's all I have to say about that. But if anybody else wants to, perhaps not just give anecdotal examples of how you've dealt with homeless people, but is anything else a bit more philosophical, a bit more Quakerly, religious, spiritual that we can contribute to this topic that Richard's raised for us? Not erased, has raised for us. Ray?
To going on from what Stephen said, there are two very big organisations which Quakers were, large amounts of Quakers were helped to set up. Not, they didn't do it on their own, but they did it with others, but it was, Quakers were quite involved in it. One of them was Anti-Slavery International, which is now a very big thing. And the other one, which is what people know very well, which was Oxfam, which a large majority of Quakers helped to set up. This is, you know, as that phrase goes, Quakers are still hitting above their size at the moment. And I think we need to take those examples and go forward.
Yeah, thank you. Sheena.
Well, I just wanted to ask Richard, how is there enough money spent with the Julian Trust or any other homeless group on funding from the social services, counselling? Because such a lot is spent on with social services now on people who are in homes who are finding it difficult. So how do you get enough people who have the right qualities to work with the homeless in the counselling sector?
Richard, can you answer that?
No, I don't think I can. I think, you know, Stephen's right. There's a political angle to all of the big changes. But, you know, as he also said, you don't get political change unless there are a lot of people persuaded it's the right thing to do. No government's going to do something that isn't popular or obviously necessary and they can persuade people is right. And the stuff that's going on at the moment sort of partly answers your question. It's all short-term government money. The stuff that's happening to keep people off the streets at the moment is pockets and pockets of funding for this, funding for that, a year for some workers here, so and so. It's not part of a long-term strategy that's got, you know, 3 to 5, oh, we'd lovely, it was 10-year funding. And so as long as you're getting funding in these short bursts, you're not going to get the continuity of staff. You've got to, you know, some of the most insecure, precarious jobs at the moment are those working in social care of the sort we're talking about and in the voluntary sector, because the funding isn't long-term and strategic. So out of this, you know, we're starting to get a commitment to long-term change in terms of the environment, although it's never going to be as quick as we want. But we haven't really got that in homelessness. This is a temporary fix because of COVID. And what we have is the opportunity to turn it into a longer term one by putting that kind of pressure on. So as long as there are organizations around like the Julian Trust, like people who are, you know, Feed the Homeless working from Champion Square, who only see their role as helping in the immediate, they're helping that government narrative of, oh, it's just something we can fix in the short term. There needs to be a much bigger movement to say, you know, this needs to be a long-term change and get that long-term commitment from the powers that be to make it happen.
Thank you. Jenny.
I'm going to jump around a bit. First of all, did friends see page 30 of the Times yesterday, where there's a letter that the Quakers and their role in slavery? I recommend you, if you can find one, we can't go into libraries now, can we? But if you can find a copy, read it. It's quite interesting. It debates the fact that we were involved in slavery initially, but Pennsylvania and other parts of the Quaker movement said it was wrong and we changed it. So it's an example of what we actually had done in the past. I started, the only way you can find out whether you're the right person to go and work there is to go and do it. I started with the Cyrenians in their soup kitchen in about 1973-4 in St. Paul's. And a lot of homeless then were people that had lost their jobs being stokers on the old coal ship. And of course, everybody went over to oil run, and that was the end of it. But as a shelter worker, can I say the one thing I think needs changing and Quakers to look at is housing legislation, how properties are built, the standards, some of them are appalling, so that when we do get people start a new life in a different way, they are put in places that are safe. I walked into home after home in Bristol, full of damp and mould. It destroys their clothing. It destroys, it makes you ill. So we've got to look at the legislation that exists now, and also in share, have fairness. Young couples are now going into rented properties. The rents are horrendous. They will never be able to own a house of their own or have anywhere safe because their landlord can evict them so fast. So I think legislation is something that Quakers should be looking at and thinking about what we would lobby to ensure that the central government changes to make life fair. Because okay. Life isn't fair.
Thank you very much, Jenny. I know you speak from massive experience. David, would you like to contribute?
Yeah, just quickly on housing, the City Council has just released a bunch of small plots of land to groups like Tiny House Community Bristol, Lockleys Neighbourhood Trust, Ashley Community Housing and so on, for next to no money whatsoever. So they're going to be building totally affordable housing, and it's almost all co-housing, so you're building communities. So I'm not a great believer in lobbying the government to make change, even though I'm occasionally involved with Extinction Rebellion. I think that that what really happens is when you demonstrate, this was Buckminster Fuller said, you know, if you want to change the world, start building examples of what it is you want to show. And we're in the middle of a huge, an epochal change at the moment. There are reports like Rethinking Humanity and the Third Industrial Revolution, which show that our economies are shifting from, in a fossil fuel economy, nothing can be more than 20% efficient. The most efficient thing in fossil fuels is the petrol engine. It's only 20% efficient. In an electric economy, everything can be 80% efficient. And when you shift from an economy which is 80% waste to an economy that's only 20% waste, the world is actually transformed. And a lot of the things that we want to do become possible. And there are, my job used to be getting companies involved in big change programs. And it all boiled down, actually, when you finally did it, to getting people to have conversations that matter with each other and with their clients, with the people around them, about what we really want, and then find ways of making it happen. And there's I wondered where we would find a change program that could work on a world scale. And I'm involved with an annual program called Theory U. This is a Professor Otto Sharma out of Massachusetts Institute of Technology with this massive online course, which is teaching people how to have deep conversations with open will, open mind, open heart. And he talks about getting people to a space where they are presencing. I believe that that concept is very, very familiar to Quakers and quite new to a lot of people in the world. And I think that by embracing this bigger picture in the world of Theory U and change through Theory U, conversations where people get really, really deep into what's needed and then make it happen. That's one of the big hopes. So it's examples and, of course, finance, making the finance available. But the finance is available once you realize that the things you want to do are cheaper than the things that you were doing. You know, so it isn't a matter of solar energy is going to take a long time to happen. It's the world's cheapest energy source. There isn't a cheaper energy source. It's going to replace. How quickly? 10 years. In 10 years, the world will be powered by solar and wind through nothing to do with government action, just through the accelerating technology change.
Okay. Thank you, David. We do have David's brilliant discussion where he expanded on the theories he's just mentioned in our discussion group a few weeks ago. It's on tape. This one has also been, it's been recorded on YouTube. This also has been recorded. So if anybody objects, please tell me. And B, you'll receive how you can access the discussion on YouTube later. Now we're coming to an end of our agreed time, although we can chat afterwards. I just want to say how glad I am we've touched on so many different approaches to change. And I do think it's valuable each person to do whatever level suits them. And I do think it's sad if different levels of change makers denigrate each other, because every little helps, I think. Richard, would you like to say any last words to round it up before we close down?
No.
No? That's a lovely little comment. Right. Well, we'll be back next week. I'll be around on email, if nothing else. The reason I went away was for a phone call, which was almost the final word in buying my new house and selling my present one. I'm actually in a very agitated state of nerves about it all. But we'll be back here next week. Patsy, you just tell us what we're looking forward to next week.
Yes, Ray's going to be talking to us about education. I haven't got the exact title in front of me, Ray. Can you?
I think he wants to abolish all private schools or something.
I've lost Ray. Is he still there? I haven't got him. Oh, there he is, Ray.
Yep, I'm still here. Basically, the title is optimistically Education for All in the 20th Century. Or 21st century, nearly.
Right, everybody. Well, thanks ever so much for coming. I think, once again, we've broken record for the numbers of people here. But some 3 times 5 is 50. 17 people. That's pretty good. So see you all next week, maybe. Thank you for your contributions.
Thank you.
Richard, just a quickie. What is your title? Working for Change.
That's what it was. Yeah.
Okay, great. I put the titles when I put it up on YouTube. So I just know what the title was.
Just for those who are ready, I put something in chat, which is because the conversation was around housing, an event coming up, which is to do with the Archbishop of Canterbury's sort of initiative. There is now a bishop for housing been appointed. And there's an event in Bristol, which is looking at, trying to basically turn church property into affordable housing. So very, very topical.
People can carry on chatting if you wish, you know.
I have to go. I just wanted to let people know what I put in chat.
Great. Bye. Yeah, thanks for that.
Jenny?
Yes?
You said your daughter's working with, is it with the council? Or she work in a charity?
No, she works for Bristol City Council, has done for years. She's in the housing department.
Yeah.
I get little bits of gems from her.
Mm.
And they've had a lot of vacancies because of deaths and people having to go into care homes because they couldn't isolate properly, but safely. And she said that Bristol have the highest rate of rehousing homeless in the country. I'd like to know if that's true.
I guess she's working with various charities to get the support for them.
Mm. What happened in the past when I worked for Shelter, she was unemployed and she came to work as a volunteer in Shelter. So she ended up working for part of the city council that did housing, which was eventually closed down, and then moved into the housing department. and she's a whiz kid on computers. And she had inherited, she's also had COVID. So she's been ill and gone back to work. She's working from home. But she went back and there was, I think she did 87 applications for housing in one day recently to get 87 people a roof over their head or an offer.
So amazing. She must be very
doing her best. I know that because she, like me, cares. Yeah.
Patty, what's that thing you're holding?
That's the loudspeaker. It's a Bluetooth loudspeaker. Even with my hearing aids, I need it for you, Jenny.
Do you want me to tell you about another daughter?
Well, I'm going to go now. I've got to. I've got some contracts to sign. I'm pleased.
Oh, good, Stephen.
But I'll leave this thing on. Cheers, Ray. See you next week, I hope. That picture of Mark Spring is unreal. It's horribly real, isn't it? It's actually a photo. It's not him.
Ah, there we go.
There he is.
But you must smile. You've got to get a photo that smiles occasionally.
All right, I've got to go. Cheers.
All right, Stephen. All right. See you.
Now my all my children work in sort of social things, do with people. I noticed that. It followed me. And well, you had a mother that didn't come in late till 2 and 3 in the morning sometimes because of eviction cases. And you're all about people having their furniture thrown out on the roads in St. Berbergs and things. Then it rubs off on your children. They're listening. Anyway, that's it. I probably screwed up their lives. They could probably have become millionaires and lived in comfort.
What for? What for?
Yeah, what for?
I mean, people are where it's at.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I go out to Southmead. You know, I was represented Southmead for 23 years. I get cuddles. It's lovely. I must be the only ex-councillor that gets cuddles.
Nice idea.
Well, what was going on there was horrendous, and we had to sort it out, didn't we? But we had to do it as gently as possible.
Yeah. It's been a good discussion today, I think, about gentleness with each other and the tolerance that you have to have whilst you're storming away with your little changes that you want to do, and you try repeatedly to enact them until it's successful, and other people don't seem to be starting. So you still have to. Well, I've decided my New Year's resolution is to keep talking about the environment and doing something. And I'm very impressed by XR, for instance, because, I mean, I know that they engage with the government. They know it's got to be political change. Has to be. But it's got to be changing the general public's thinking as well. But
I think the environment's really important at the moment.
Yeah.
I mean, that storm yesterday was very, very bad up here.
Yeah. Where's up here, Jenny?
Stockwood. It's on a hill. It's on the edge of Dundry.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. I mean, people, by the time it hits Dundry, it's pushing the wind up. So it goes over the city a bit more.
As
it goes past us, it's very cool.
Thank you, Jenny.
Bye. Take care. God bless you all.
Bye. Hello. Yeah, Hattie here. No, I just need to put the volume off, you know, shut up the... Oh, God, sorry. I'm in a Zoom meeting. I've just got to either mute myself or leave.
Gone, yeah.